there's a real atmosphere in here of expectation, and I was vacillating between two sermons, and I heard the Holy Spirit very quickly bring me back to what was my first mind, and I'm praying that this is a word that will speak to you. I just want to make sure I'm in the right church, though. We're at the Thrive Conference. Pastor was talking this morning about this concept of forever. And I was fascinated by this thing. And he said something in his closing dialogue to us before we broke for afternoon break. He said, you know, I like to be challenged when I come to church. I like to think. He's a thinker. He's a voracious reader. This, he said he used to read dictionaries when he was little. I was like, weird. But, you know, whatever. Whatever you want to do, it's cool. I'm going to play video games, go outside, eat a snow cone if you want. Aardvark. Apple. Good for you. Pastor did something right after offering. He shifted the atmosphere. He sensed something. And when you go through things, you're more sensitive to the Holy Spirit. He sensed something and he said, come on, lift your hands. And he just began to speak into the atmosphere. He said, the same God that spoke to Moses in the burning bush is here right now. The same God that was here is now here. His character has not changed. His power has not changed. His methods may have changed, but his momentum has not changed. From Moses to right now, that God is here. Now, the Old Testament revelation of God was rooted in the law, but we have come through the gift of grace. And so this 400-year silence between Malachi and Matthew, this middle place, and then all of a sudden there was the announcement of a birth of a baby to shepherds in a field, which is strange because shepherds in Jewish culture was the lowest possible position you could have. It was common knowledge that if you were walking or rolling past with your own horse or with your own cart and saw a shepherd in a ditch, you were not obligated to pick him up out of that ditch. Shepherds could not testify in open court. They were the lowest on the totem pole. Why would God send angels to announce the greatest announcement in the history of mankind to shepherds in a field at night? Why wouldn't he go to the king's palaces? Why wouldn't he wake up all the world leaders and say, everybody get up because my son is in the building? He made sure to make the announcement to shepherds. Why? Because he didn't come to save the highest of the high. He came to save the lowest of the low. And it's from this mindset that I started processing this word, because when we think of redemption, when we think of salvation, when we think of church, many multiple things comes to mind based on your own experience. But I want to know, is the Jesus that I have encountered, this great God that I have been made aware of, truly, is he the same yesterday, today, and forever? What about, I know he's there when I'm good, because clearly, you know, when I'm trying to serve him, he's there. He's like, good job. But, you know, sometimes I get a little nervous that maybe the God of the law might show up when I'm doing some bad stuff, like he's up in heaven waiting for me to mess up, like, oh, do something else, do, ooh. I'm getting ready to throw this down there. I just made this up. It's a new disease. I don't even know what it is. I'm gonna throw it down. Sin one more time. And sometimes I battle with this concept of a loving God who, no effort of my own, loves me. Not the me that you see, but the authentic me, the me that you don't see on a platform, the you that we don't see, because most of us have mastered the art of cosmetic Christianity. We project what we want you to believe, but very rarely do we live an authentic Christian life. You know, we know the church language. How you doing? Blessed, blessed in the city, blessed in the field, blessed when I come and blessed when I go. The enemy comes in one way, but he is fleeing seven ways, and the devil is under my feet. That's your projected image. But what if you really told the truth of your situation? How you doing? I'm a mess. My life is stressed. My husband is getting on my nerves. I want to stab him in Jesus' name. These kids are getting on my nerves. I want to say the wrong thing to my boss. Somebody cut me off on the highway and I almost lost my Holy Ghost. I said, you, mama say, mama samu makusa. No, you didn't. Just cut me off. The tension in the Christian life is the tension and the distance found between your projected image and your actual self. Most of the tension in our lives is based on our projected image and our actual self, and we're trying to juggle these two realities and hoping that people see us as we want to be seen. But sometimes life happens and there's nowhere for you to go. Because all it takes is one moment and your life can change. And you won't be able to hide behind religion anymore. You won't be able to hide behind nice church lingo. There will come a time in all of our lives when we will have to call on the name of Jesus in a raw, real, desperate way. I don't imagine that any of us will be able to escape the earth without crying out in desperation, Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me. I believe one of the great tragedies of Western Christianity is casual Christianity, where we are able to take for granted what so many people have to whisper and sneak around for. There are places in this world where if you are caught with a Bible, you are killed on the spot. And here we are able to freely, right now, we're able to freely congregate. I notice I said right now because there's so many voices now trying to mute the church. And devil, you are a liar. The church is not going anywhere. What do you do when life happens? I know it's easy to worship when everything's going well. But can you worship? Can you trust when all is lost? What do you do when your dream falls to the ground? What do you do when it looks like hope has died? What do you do when the thing you were believing for hasn't come to pass? How do we as believers handle adversity? I know what the scripture says, but we live in this world and we need to have honest dialogue about our hopes, our dreams, our heart, our aspirations. Guys like Job, they scare me. How in the world did this man worship in the midst of everything he was going through? He lost it all and he has the nerve to blurt out, naked I came in, naked I'm leaving, blessed be the name of the Lord. I don't know that I'm there yet. What do you do when it doesn't go your way? Anybody in here holding on to a word that God spoke? Anybody in here? I got three people. The rest said, no, he ain't never spoke to me. I don't. Don't be worried. We're going to have fun in a minute. I just got to set this thing up because I need to make sure I'm talking to the right church, because the enemy wants to steal your faith before the word shows up. The manifestation of the word, because it's already been declared, you will live and not die. You will see the salvation of the Lord in the earth. You will see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. You will be the head and not the tail. The promise of God is yea and amen in Christ Jesus. I don't know who this is for, but you cannot lose hope. Is there anybody holding on to a word? 19 of us If you're not holding on to a word, you need to ask the Lord to give you a word. Because if you don't have a word, it'll be very, very difficult to maintain spiritual momentum. You need to know that God has spoken something specific about you. May I offer Isaiah 55 that says, for as the rain comes down from heaven and the snow and water the earth and do not return there, but that it would bring forth in bud, that it would give seed to the sower and bread to the eater, so shall my word be that flows forth from my mouth. It shall not return to me void, but it shall accomplish that for which I sent it. May I offer that you, sir, are not just a human being, but a word that God spoke. Your name has a purpose attached. And when God speaks, God only speaks in the language of solutions. When he spoke your name, he saw a problem in the earth, and he spoke you as a solution to a demonic problem. I need you to understand, you cannot sneak into the earth. You have to be spoken into the earth. There are no accidental lives. You are here because God wanted you here. No matter what people have said, you are not a mistake. You are not an accident. I don't care about family planning. You are the express intent of God. You are the will of God. You are the image of God. You carry the power of God, and you have the seed of God, and God has not changed his mind about you. What do you do when the thing that Jesus said isn't the thing you're experiencing? Go with me to the scripture, because I want to encourage anybody who might be in the midst of a faith crisis. I need you to be able to thrive in the process, because the end result is a done deal. What you do in the process actually develops your character and your testimony. But what he said has to happen, because not one thing that God has ever said has come back to him void. It just can't happen. Whatever he said, that's what it's going to be. Hallelujah. I want you to go to John chapter 11. We were singing these songs, and Israel, who is one of my closest friends, I believe is one of the great worship unifiers in the body of Christ. I'm so grateful to be here tonight and share the platform of ministry with him. We can sing these songs and we lift our hands, but it's not just his amazing anointing or his gifted voice or the talent of those who minister with him. It is actually the words, the substance of the sound. It stirs our faith. And when we sing these songs, something on the inside of us testifies that God is real, and I still believe that God has a plan for my life. And so when I lift my hands, it is an acknowledgement that there is someone in control of the affairs of my life, and I don't have to worry anymore, because everything concerning me has already been worked out. We sing these songs and these words. I can't stress to you enough the power of your words. In this season, the currency of your breakthrough is words. In this season, the currency of your deliverance is words. In this season, the currency of your miracle is words. If you have the faith to speak it, God has the power to bring it to pass. But many of us sometimes struggle with a little bit of doubt, because we've spoken something and it hasn't shown up yet. Or we've spoken a thing and it didn't happen when we thought it would or should. So check out my Savior, because he's awesome. John chapter 11, verse 1. Now a certain man was sick, Lazarus of Bethany, the town of Mary and her sister Martha. It was that Mary who anointed the Lord with fragrant oil and wiped his feet with her hair, whose brother Lazarus was sick. Therefore, the sisters sent to him, saying, Lord, behold, he whom you love is sick. When Jesus heard that, he said, this sickness is not unto death, but for the glory of God, that the Son of God might be glorified through it. Keep that right over there, okay? Now, Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. So when he heard that he was sick, he stayed 2 more days in the place where he was. Freeze. Now, hold on, baby Jesus. Jesus with a goatee. Teenage Jesus, I'm not even sure. Whichever one will hear this prayer, I need to kind of understand your thinking right here. Lazarus was not a disciple. Lazarus was Jesus' friend. Imagine the perks of having Jesus as your friend. Nobody messed with Lazarus. Like, hey, man, hey, Lazarus, say something else. Like, what? You don't want me to call Jesus, do you? He will tear you up. Jesus was his friend. And the Bible says, you know, and Israel sings a song, I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. He calls me friend. A little bit of Cowardly Lion for y'all. You know, it's a great song. But what happens when God's not being very friendly towards your circumstance? Is he still our friend when he doesn't answer our prayer? Isn't it hard to worship when you're believing for something and other people, their prayers are answered? It's like, oh, you got a raise? Oh, praise God. Girl, you got engaged? Oh, hallelujah. Any day now, Jesus. Isn't it hard to celebrate other people when you waiting on God to show up? I want you to know it's okay to worship with an attitude. It'll bless you. Just be, because it's real relationship. The Bible says those that worship must worship in spirit and in truth, not spirit and perfection. So I don't have to be anything other than what I actually am. So there have been times that I've been worshiping. I am a friend of God. I'm mad at you. I am a friend of God. I don't really want to speak to you. I am a friend of God. Answer my prayers. Jesus, they come tell him, Jesus, oh my goodness, Lazarus is sick. Your best friend, Lazzy Laz, he is sick. Oh my goodness, you gotta get there. You gotta get to Bethany, it is bad. Do you understand? And Jesus is like, oh my goodness, for real? Okay, thank you for letting me know. All right, I appreciate that. Let me just tell it to you like this. This sickness is not unto death, but for the glory of God, that the Son of God might be glorified through it. Okay, I appreciate what you said, but he's still sick. You ever heard a word from God like, no, you didn't understand. I'm in a desperate situation. I don't need no words. I need some action. Not only did Jesus speak it, the Bible says it goes on to be descriptive. And he loved Mary and Martha and Lazarus. He loved them so much that he stayed where he was 2 more days. Ruby Roo. Have you ever prayed a prayer? You were desperate. God, I'm in trouble. I know. God, I need you. I hear you, honey. God, I'm calling on you. I need her right now. Amen. I'll talk to you in a couple days. It was bad when the word got to him. It got worse while he stayed where he was. Have you ever prayed about a thing that went from bad to worse? Why would Jesus let that happen? So then the next thing is I want you to go down to the 11th verse. The 11th verse says, these things he said, and after that he said to them, our friend Lazarus sleeps, but I go that I may wake him up. And the disciples said, Lord, if he sleeps, he'll get well. However, Jesus spoke of his death, but they thought he was speaking about taking rest and sleep. Then Jesus said to them plainly, Lazarus is dead. Okay, I'm confused. and then he takes it, and I'm glad. Now you're being rude, Jesus. I'm glad for your sakes that I was not there, that you may believe. Nevertheless, let us go to him. My title for the few minutes that I have with you, simply three words: it's not over. It's not. Let's break this story down. When Jesus gets the word, they tell him what the issue is. He speaks to the situation. This sickness is not unto death, but that the glory of God might be revealed, that God would get glory through this situation. That's the first thing he said. Then the next thing that he says is, our friend Lazarus sleeps. Then after that, he says, he gone. It's over. And he says, I'm glad he's gone so that you may believe. Now I need you to just rewind to right here when he said, our friend Lazarus sleeps. Because I need you to catch that sometimes you're not going to understand what God is doing in your life. And you're going to have to maintain faith throughout the process and trust that everything that he's doing is actually working for your good. And you will thrive after it's all said and done. Hallelujah. I need you to understand that some of the people around you won't even be able to comprehend what God is doing. Jesus spoke a thing, and the disciples, bless their dense little hearts. These were not the brightest dudes in Jerusalem. Jesus did not pick them out of the synagogue and the rabbinical school. These were not the top priestly minds. So he was like, our friend Lazarus sleeps. They're like, all right, well, if he sleeps, ain't no reason to go all the way down there. We might as well stay where we are, you understand? Because he could just get a nap and wake up, he'd be feeling fine. Ain't nothing wrong with him. He sleep. Why we got to go down there and he sleep? Now, I'm sure you don't read that in your version, but it is in the NIV, which is the Negro International Version. You can purchase it in the lobby at my product table. It is whoop-de-woo. If he sleep, then you just let him go to sleep, take a nap. He'll wake up, he'd be good as new. The disciples were not the brightest dudes in Jerusalem. Then Jesus said, look, he gone. Let's go. Now I need you to catch the progression, because I need you to understand that the same God that pastor said talked to Moses is here, which means he's the same yesterday, today, and forever. So let's head towards the city. The Bible says when Jesus got there, he had already been in the tomb 4 days. As he comes into the city, Martha runs out. Oh my goodness. No, I wasn't ready. Oh. I wasn't ready. She says, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. I need you to understand the desperation of this moment, that these two women relied on Lazarus to be their covering. And in this culture, if there was any debt that was outstanding, this could be a dangerous situation. They were not married. Scripture doesn't say that they were, and they were there. They loved Lazarus. That was their covering. For him to die was a significant blow to them, and it could have long-term ramifications. It wasn't just, I lost somebody I love. I lost the person that provided for us, that protected us, that covered us. This was a desperate, dire situation. If you ever needed Jesus, he needed to show up a little earlier than 4 days after the funeral. The Bible says Martha ran out, but Mary stayed at the house. And that's why I figure like Mary must have been a sister. She had an attitude. Yeah, you want to show up 4 days later for real? We told you he was sick, and you just, hold on, my braids is itching. Hold on, hold on. You really gonna show up? He outside? I don't care. I'm not moving. I'm gonna stay in the house. Don't make him no plate. You better put that macaroni and cheese down. Put them rolls in. He don't get no chicken. Jesus, you don't get no chicken. You knew good and well that my brother was sick, and you wait until he dead, and you want to show up 4 days later. You want us to walk outside? Whatever. Boop, boop, boop. And you know, Jesus, in all the movies, he always has a British accent. I'm sure he's like, why dost thou speakest to me in such tone? Don't you know who I am? I am the great Yeshua of Bethlehem, the son of Mary. I don't care who you are, you should have got here a little sooner. Okay, boo-boo, Mr. Walk on Water, Mr. Stretch Out the Withered Hand, Mr. Five Loaves and Two Fish, all of that, but your best friend's sick and you don't show up? Uh-oh, it just fell off. Help me, Jesus. My wig, Jesus. Martha says, if you had been here, my brother wouldn't have died. And Jesus says this, your brother will rise again. And she said, I know, he'll rise at the resurrection at the last day. He said, no, you miss it. Resurrection's not an event. Resurrection is a man. I am the resurrection and the life. Somebody needs to get this revelation. I don't care what it looks like. The I am has just stepped in to your situation. I don't know what the doctor's report says, but the I am has just stepped into your situation. I don't know what neighborhood you live in, but the I am is walking around El Paso, Texas, and the surrounding regions, and he's getting ready to do miracles, signs, and wonders. Is there anybody in this church that knows that I am still has all power? I'm trying to keep it together, but I feel like crying and worshiping, but I gotta finish this word. Because I need you to understand this concept of forever. Yesterday, today, and forever. Oh, help me, Holy Ghost. Martha goes back with this encouragement, whispers to Mary. Mary, still mad, says she gets up, rushes out. She sees him. She's overcome with emotion. She falls at his feet, worships, and says, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. The next thing out of Jesus' mouth was, show me where you laid him. I need you to catch this. Mary and Martha said the same thing. One got his attention. The other got his anointing. Martha got his attention, but the worship unlocked the anointing. Can you worship in your pain? Can you worship with the question? Can you worship when it makes no sense? Can you bless him when you don't have enough to pay all the bills? Can you lift your hands when life makes no sense? What do you do at your lowest point? Because what you do at your lowest point is what you are at your highest. Are there any worshipers in here? I know you're sitting down, but even sitting down, can you just give him a praise with your hands? I feel the Holy Ghost in here, Holden. I just need a little strength, brother. Every now and then you need somebody to encourage your soul. When you're going through it, you can't go through alone. We are not called to be Christian islands. We exist in community. We will thrive in community. You cannot thrive outside of community. We need one another. Oh, help me, Holy Ghost. If you're struggling, you don't struggle alone. We overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. You got to talk to somebody. Anyway, check this out. Jesus says, show me where you laid him. Now, there was a great stone. I need you to understand that that word stone in the Greek is the same word used for tablet or law in Hebrew. That's why I need you to catch what Jesus did. He knew in his physical form when he got the news about Lazarus that he would not be able to physically get there before this man died. So what did he do? He sent his word. This sickness is not unto death, but for the glory of God, that the Son of God might be glorified through it. The moment it left his mouth, it took off in the direction of Bethany. Listen to me. The word rushed through circumstance. Watch this. It didn't stop at the house, Pastor Charles, where Lazarus was laid sick and dying. The word actually went to the grave where they were going to lay the body, and the word was in there waiting on the body to show up. I said, it's not over. That's the title of the message. It's not over. Catch this. So when Jesus speaks, when he shows up, he's already dead. But don't worry, he sent his word. But the stone has sealed this thing. That's why I had to send my word, because I hadn't died yet. So under the law, if that stone had been over there, I wouldn't have been able to do what I'm about to do. Because I came to fulfill the law. So I had to speak the word before the law could get a hold to the situation. See, here's where the enemy tries to mess us up. He tries to interrupt your story. Interrupt your story with sickness, with divorce, bad decisions. He hits you with all of these things in the middle of your story, and you think that God has somehow written some terrible chapter, but you need to catch who Jesus is, because what Jesus says at the first will stand at the last, because he is the Aleta. He is the Alpha and the Omega. He is the beginning, and he is the end. So it really doesn't matter what happens in the middle, because he already declared the end. Will somebody give him a praise if you know God has declared the end from the beginning? Can you give him a praise because you know your ending is sure in Christ Jesus? The devil can read your story, but he can't write your story. 10-second praise break, 10-second praise break. I said the devil can read your story, but he can't write your story. I don't care what you've gone through. There's only one who has the pen, and he is the one who's already made up his mind about you. Your story is not written in ink. It's written in blood. The blood of your Savior has sealed your destiny. Jesus said, I don't care what the law says. That stone represents the law. I just need to let you know that the law doesn't have power over grace. I am grace walking. Help me, Holy Ghost. I love what he said. He said, roll the stone away. Get the law out of the way. Stop operating in this legalistic mindset, this performance-based Christianity, this works-based relationship, hoping that God will somehow love you if you scream louder or worship harder or give more money. It's not those things that causes God to love you. God's love for you is eternal, enduring, unending, incomprehensible, and there's nothing you can do to make God love you any more than he already does, which means there's nothing you can do to make God love you any less. The law has been nullified through the grace found in Jesus Christ. It's not over. It actually is over. I just realized there's a clock down there. Oops. Because Israel taking all along, singing all your little songs. Can't give no black preacher 30 minutes anyway. That's like giving a whale a tic-tac. This is, it just doesn't work. Jesus said, roll the stone away. And then Jesus says three words. Lazarus, come forth. Now I need you to understand why he was specific. Because if he had simply screamed out, come forth, in a cemetery, everybody dead would have got up. But he was specific to Lazarus. And I need you to know that God is specific with your resurrection. He's specific with your miracle. I hope you get this. Thrive Conference, there is a miracle with your name on it. There is a healing with your name on it. There is a breakthrough with your name on it. There is deliverance with your name on it. Here comes Lazarus walking out of the tomb like a mummy from the Thriller video. I want you to know Jesus is gonna hit y'all with some thrilling miracles. If you got any midnight in your life, you need to get excited because Jesus specializes in midnight moments. It's close to midnight. Something evil's lurking in the dark. Under the moonlight, the Holy Spirit really wants your heart. So close your eyes and realize this is not imagination. Come on, thrive, and all the while, the King of Kings, he wants your very life, your very life. His name is Jesus, Jesus Christ, bled and died and rose just to give eternal life. His name is Jesus, ooh, Jesus Christ, bled and died and rose to bring you eternal life. Loose him and let him go. It's not over. Dead, buried in the ground. But what preserved his body? His word got there before the body did. I need you to know, I don't care how bad it looks in your life, the word was already sent before the situation got worse. My final point. Jesus knew that this level of miracle, he wouldn't have anybody that would understand it. So he had to send his word ahead of himself. Because this kind of miracle, you're gonna need somebody to bear witness. Because by the power of two, a testimony is established. So Jesus had to agree with himself. So he sent his word to speak back to him. Lazarus, get on up. Your dad, get on up. Stay on the scene, get on up like a holy machine. Get on up. Lazarus, get on up. Hey, get on up. I need you to understand that when he got up, it was Jesus bringing the story together. the Alpha and the Omega, with Lazarus in the middle. And whatever's dead in your life is about to get up and begin to thrive. It's not over. I said it's not over. It's not finished. I said it again. It's not over. It's not finished. It hasn't ended. If God is in it, all things are new. Can somebody give him a praise? Hallelujah. If you're in here right now and there was something that was dead in your life, buried, you thought it was gone, never to return. Maybe you thought you were finished. Bad decisions, falling away from the love of God found in Jesus Christ. Tonight is your night to come home. If you need to come home, I'm here to tell you three words as your brother. It's not over. If there's something in your life that you need to be resurrected, meet me at this altar right now. Come on down here. Don't wait. Don't delay. If it's your marriage that's on the rocks, come on down here. It's not over. If you need to give your life to Jesus Christ, it's not over. Come on. I bet you if you praise God, more people will have the faith to walk down to this altar. It's not over. 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 It's not over.